Indians discovered places eons ago that you and I may discover here today and think is the best thing since sliced bread. But my goal in publicizing these secret slash special places is to increase the visibility of them so that people will visit them, so that they will be committed to conservation. There are so many players involved in conserving, you know, natural spaces, trying to preserve natural spaces so that they have some remnant of a look, function as the way these woods and prairies and bays and lakes looked before they were inundated with the arrival of people. I think about the Rocky Mountain Elk Foundation. They contributed to the development of a new wildlife area directly north of Merrill Lake. We're not hunters, but hunters are invested in preserving natural spaces too. Those who love nature, they are among the collaborators. I think about a secret place that may be more secret than some, by virtue of the fact that this is not on public lands, it's on warehouse land. There is a peak, the name slips my mind, it's south of Yelm, it's on Weyerhaeuser lands that are served by the Vail Operations Center, that you can visit this peak. There's a trail to it, but you have to get permission to, you have to go to the Weyerhaeuser site and request permission to take the trail. It's actually a climbing peak. That you could also drive in the vicinity during hunting season, but you have to pay $200 for access to the gate that will get you in the vicinity. So here is a spot of great beauty and recreational benefit that is in the hands of private concerns that have not necessarily made it super easy to access this. So take that into consideration as well. But these timber companies, as they come to recognize the value of lands that maybe they've already harvested, are moving to, the owners of these lands are moving to release those lands and put them into public use. The Merrill Lake Wildlife Area is such an area. It was logged maybe multiple times over the eons. And the owner could have sold that land for homes, cabins. It borders the northern part of the lake. There are just a few cabins on Merrill Lake in the south end. Could have made a lot more money by developing that land for cabins, for private ownership, but instead chose to sell it to the Rocky Mountain Foundation in conjunction with the Washington State Department of Fish and Wildlife, which is managing the property, putting it into public use. There are 4 campsites on in this area. We noticed, we checked them out here a couple of weeks ago. These are hunter camp type campsites, dispersed sites, which add to the options for someone who wishes to camp in the Lake Merrill area. The Lake Merrill campground itself is a lovely campground. Oh, so lovely, with a beautiful nature trail to the south of it. But when those sites are full, where does a camper stay? Well, he does have the option of those dispersed sites just north of the lake in the Merrill Lake Wildlife area. So, yeah, we're talking, what's a secret place? Yeah, there aren't any secrets to keep anymore, folks. A lot of special places. We're in this boat together. We want to preserve public lands. We want to live with animals, and we want to preserve petrified wood, and we want to preserve dinosaur bones, and we want to preserve mushrooms, and we want to preserve berry fields. And the way we do that is by working together, seeing that these all have value, seeing that we can pick berries, look for petrified wood, look for mushrooms, find fossilized rocks on a beach, as long as there's kind of a rule or a value that has been embraced that says this is for the many, not for the few, and certainly not just for the one. The era of individualism, I own it, therefore I have it, and therefore you can't have it, ever. It really runs counter to what is the ethic of the day. So, anyway, here we are, December 24th, lovely spot, counting our blessings, thinking about how to keep warm. Every time we go out, we got some other, come up with, we're aware of things we may have forgotten to take, or things we need to do to make our camping experience even better. I learned today, don't put your tent on a place where you can't have all four poles level on the ground. Okay, see that corner right there? That corner's up a foot because of the hillside. And as a consequence, my tent is cattywomp, what is it? Crooked. But we adapt, everything works, relatively speaking, a few adaptations. My rain fly was limping, wilted, so I rigged up. Anyway, so I learned, look for flat for all four corners of your tent if you want to have a tent that doesn't look like an amateur doing it for the first time has erected the tent. We also learned, today that boots, muck boots, are great for muck. But a muck boot, it's a wet weather boot. We need insulated boots to really be comfortable in sub-freezing weather. Got a couple wool socks on. My feet could be still a little warmer. I've certainly tested out the importance of having layers. And so, again, I've got the old line coat. I've got the orange fleece. I've got, is it wool? Maybe it's wool. Shirt. I've got a flannel shirt under that. I've got an old sweatshirt under that, and I got an undershirt. At the beginning of the chain. That's how you keep warm. You need to take something off. You do it from chopping wood. Take off the coat, maybe even the fleece. If I'm sitting by the fire after dark, that's such a lovely experience. I'm gonna have all of this that I have on today, plus I pull out my frog talk and add that layer on top of everything. I pulled a frog talk pants on over my jeans last night. Our first night here, I didn't have my long johns on, so I needed that extra layer. Today I got the long johns, I got the jeans, maybe tonight I'll pull the frog togs on. When the sun goes down, we gathered around the fire, enjoying those 3 hours before bedtime. Bedtime's 8 o'clock. We went to bed at 7 o'clock last night, couldn't keep our eyes open. It was cold. And we're just ready. And we slept. We got up at 7:15 this morning. Can you believe that? Old people sleeping for 12 hours? Well, there were some wakeful periods there, but this is the most incredible place to sleep. Sleeping in the cold, when you're warm in the cold, is the most lovely way to catch up on sleep. How much sleep do I get at home?